Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to the Center for International Governance Innovation, or CG as we say. My name is Fred Kuntz, and I'm the Vice President of Public Affairs here at CG. Thanks for joining us for the first signature lecture of 2015. I'd also like to thank our public event sponsor, Wordsworth Books, for their continued support of our signature lecture series. Thanks also to those who are joining us tonight through our live webcast. Following this evening's address, we welcome questions from both audiences here in the CG auditorium at the microphones at the bottom of the stairs and through the live chat function on your screen if you're watching at home. Please remember to state your name and to keep the questions brief. Any threat to the integrity of Canada's good old hockey game is bound to garner national attention. So when tonight's speaker suggests hockey, among other sports, is vulnerable to the corruption and match fixing seen in the sport of soccer, Canadians may be quick to go on the defensive. Tonight, investigative journalist, academic, and documentary filmmaker Declan Hill will speak to us about the threat facing Canadian sports and how the corruption we see in the world of soccer could seep into other international and domestic sporting events. So here to introduce tonight's speaker is Thomas Homer Dixon. Tad, as we know him, is a professor at the University of Waterloo and the Balsley School of International Affairs. He's a CG chair in global systems, an expert in complexity and climate change, and is currently investigating the ideological nature of conflict. Please join me in welcoming Tad to introduce tonight's speaker.
Thank you, Fred. Absolutely delighted that you could all come out this evening to hear Declan, an old friend of mine. Welcome to the folks, too, who are online or watching this on the video. Declan and I first met each other, and this is always a bit disconcerting, 22 years ago, I suppose. So we're talking about 1992. I guess it's actually 23 years ago now. When he was in a student in a fourth year seminar I was teaching at the University of Toronto. And Declan marked himself in a group of very unusual and extremely talented students as, in many respects, the most remarkable of all. In the course of this seminar, Declan decided he wanted to do some field research. So I think in the middle of this seminar, which was on environmental stress and violent conflict in developing countries, he took himself off to Assam in northeast India to do some field work. I think this was over the Christmas holidays. And came back and presented his primary field research in this undergraduate seminar. That research was eventually compiled and used by Declan in a documentary for Ideas, I think a two or a three-part documentary, which ended up winning an award, and this was all before he even started graduate work. So I had Declan on my radar screen at that point, thinking, wow, this is a very interesting fellow. And we've stayed in touch as friends and distant colleagues ever since. So it's very special for me this evening to welcome Declan here to CG, to introduce him to our community, to show him the building, to talk to him about the Balsillie School, and to learn more about his activities in the many years since we saw a lot of each other. Just before I read the biographical information I have about Declan here and introduce him, just a little bit of information about how the evening is going to be organized. Declan will speak for about 45, 50 minutes or so, and then the two of us will sit on stage and I will ask a few questions to start the conversation for 10 or 15 minutes, and then we'll go into Q&A for the remainder of our session. I think we're going to be concluding around 8:30 or so. Is that correct, Fred? Is that when 8:30, quarter to 9 is when we'll wrap up? So let's get on to the main event, because you don't want to hear from me this evening, and I certainly don't want to hear from myself. So a little bit of bump on Declan. Declan is an investigative journalist, documentary maker, and academic. He specializes in the study of organized crime and international issues. He broke the story of match-fixing gangs destroying international football in his book, The Fix, Soccer and Organized Crime, which is for sale outside. It has now become a bestseller in 20 languages. I'm deeply, deeply envious. Before publishing The Fix, Hill completed documentaries on the killing of the head of the Canadian Mafia. blood feuds in Kosovo and ethnic cleansing in Iraq. He has also made documentaries in Kurdistan, Bolivia, India, Mexico, and Turkey. He's won a number of national and international awards from organizations such as Amnesty International, the Canadian Association of Journalists, and Play the Game. He worked for CBC Radio, Ideas, Tapestry, Dispatches, The Current, and Iraq Unit. These are all the shows he worked for. CBC Television in the Fifth Estate, Disclosure in the News World and News World International, and PBS Frontline. His programs and articles have appeared on BBC Radio World Service and BBC Radio 4, The Guardian, and The Sunday Telegraph in London, as well as various news media outlets. He was a Chevening Scholar at Green College, University of Oxford, where he obtained his doctorate on the study of match fixing in professional football. He has also testified before the Council of Europe, the International Olympic Committee, and other sports agencies. You can pick this up from his bio, and it's something I want to stress. Declan is, he describes himself as an investigative journalist, but he is an investigative journalist unlike any other investigative journalist I've ever known. With a deep theoretical understanding, who's able to root his reportage in the leading thinking and knowledge developed by scholars around the world on the issues he's reporting. So it's wonderful to have you with us this evening, Declan, in an institution that tries to bridge that divide between theory and practice, between scholarship and the real world. So very much looking forward to hearing from you. Thank you.
Thank you. Tad's a friend. Let me start by introducing you to, I wouldn't say I'm a friend, but some of the kind of guys that I hang around with and do my research with. Brian, can we close the door? Chris, lights down. Jacob, please.
You know, I'm not going to sugarcoat anything. That life at times is a violent life. And if you had to use the threat of violence or violence itself to get your jobs done, you'd do it. And, you know, unfortunately, I know of cases where an athlete was put in a hospital, you know, or handicapped in a way that he couldn't play the game. It happens. I'm Michael Francis, and for almost 20 years of my life, I was a made man in the Colombo crime family in New York, one of the five New York La Cosa Nostra families. I was involved in gambling. I had a major gambling operation. When you're involved in that life, some way, somehow, you're involved in gambling. And I had, at any point in time, 12 or 13 bookmakers working for me. Obviously, their targets were always athletes. They're pretty easy to exploit. And, you know, to me, it was great. I mean, great business. I mean, you know, we can get athletes going along with us to compromise the outcome of a game. Terrific, because there was big money in it. So it was major, major business for me. We know in life it says that when you borrow money, you become a slave to the lender. Well, when you're an athlete and you get involved with a gambler, you become a slave to the fixer. It's the same thing. You're going to do his bidding. Once you cross that line, do one thing for that gambler, you become his slave. You know, we used to hang out in some of the clubs, you know, in Manhattan, Brooklyn, where a lot of the college teams would come in and play, St. John's, some of the major universities. And a lot of these basketball players would go to the same clubs. They like to hang out. They like to party. Mob guys love to party. We live for that. And we'd get our eye on one or two of the guys and wine them and dine them. Hey, come on over to the table. We're your friends. Sit down. Have a bite to eat. You know, bring a few women over. Give them attention. And these are women that we knew. You know, probably we had something to do at the club most of the time. And you kind of bring this along once, twice, three times, four times. Finally, you set them up for the conversation because we're friends now. Yeah, sit down. Let me talk to you. I said, listen, you're a smart guy. I'm your good friend. Let me tell you how you're going to make some money. $10,000 in my pocket, pull it out, put it on a table in front of them. More money than they ever seen in cash in their life. Once we get it, they get into us, so to speak. Then they do whatever they're told to do. And that's it. And, you know, inevitably, the scenario that I just described, it always turns. And the way it'll turn is this. Athletes have a harder time underperforming than they do overperforming, because they're athletes at heart, especially these young kids in college. These are not criminals right off the bat. These are young kids. And it gets into their heads. And eventually they'll come back and say, you know what, I got 20 grand, 30 grand, 40 grand. I can't do this anymore. You know, it's getting to me. You know, thank you very much for the opportunity. And my response was always the same. Excuse me, we had a deal. You don't break your word with me. You got 10 games to go. You're done when I tell you you're done. That's it. Again, there's no love relationship between a mob guy and whoever their player is, or their pawn, or whoever it is. They're there to make money, and that's it. I've been to every Major League Baseball team, most of the NFL, all the NBA, and over 400 universities here in America, and spoke to every student athlete. You would be surprised how naive these people are. They know what they're doing on the field, but they're very naive when it comes to the business of gambling. When I do a football team, I get the biggest guy in a, you know, usually a guard, you know, or tackle. I said, stand up. They get all nervous. I said, stand up. What are you worried about? You're three times my size. Stand up. And they'll stand up, and I'll say, you're pretty good on the field. I wouldn't match up with you in any way, shape, or form. I said, but I'll tell you what. You cross this line, and you come into my business, the business of gambling, I said, I'll make a sissy out of you. I said, because I don't play by the rules, and I'm not afraid to hurt you, and I ain't going to fight you. I said, I'll get you the way I got to get you. I said, so you don't want to know somebody like me.
Ladies and gentlemen, there's always been fixing and corruption in sport. I beg you, if you leave tonight, have this idea in your head that Hill is not coming riding over the horizon saying, guess what, there's corruption in sport. That's not what I'm saying. If we were to go to the site of the ancient Olympic Stadium, built in 753 BC or pre-Common Era, whichever term you want, you would find, even now, outside the stadium is a row of statues. And those statues were built with fines taken from athletes and coaches that were caught cheating almost 2,000 years ago. So fixing and cheating and sports corruption is not new. But there's something that's happening in our generation, on our watch, when we are entrusted with protecting sport and passing it on to our children. It's an extraordinary new form of fixing and corruption in sport that we've never seen before. And it's devastating and destroying sports around the world. Pretty big words, eh? Bet you're all sitting there thinking, who is this guy? Why, who is this Hill character comes around? Oh, the sports world is going to end. Oh, I feel like one of those Old Testament prophets, you know, wild honey and locusts, and I'm coming out of the desert to warn you guys. Let me give you a little bit of background. Tad and Fred have been really amazingly kind, but let me tell you about my two hats that I wear. One is an investigative journalist, and I got into this interest in corruption in sport when I investigated for PBS Frontline and Fifth Estate the links between the Russian mafia and key players in the National Hockey League. And then I was fortunate, largely due to Tad, who wrote a great letter of reference for me to the University of Oxford in England, to start studying match fixing in soccer. And as part of my doctoral research, I wore hidden cameras and recording devices, and I went, quote, undercover and into a gang of match fixers who travel around the world fixing games. I will show you some of the video, and I'll explain how those gangs work tonight, and I'll explain why Canadian sports are under threat from them. The other hat that I wear is an academic. I've written a book based on my doctoral thesis, which understands the nitty-gritty of this new form of corruption. It explains questions like, why do athletes fix games? Like, why does an athlete with enormous amount of prestige, with enormous purportedly amount of money, risk their career to do this? I look at the statistics of it. I used what I think are relatively innovative ways of research to get this out. However, Tad and Fred and I were talking over dinner, and they said, look, this is for the public, so just talk it like straight about your investigative journalist work. So that is what I will do tonight. However, to any academics in the room, I peer at you, you look like an academic. I beg you, sir, please don't think that I haven't done the academic work. Please. If you want, I'm happy to come back and do a lecture on innovative academic methods. Happy to do that. But please don't write off my academic work because I'm going to tell you a, quote, sexy story about globalized sports corruption, okay? It's a commitment from any academic in the room. Thank you. Before I start, can I also mention a couple of names? Brian Acheson, who was guarding the door. Kevin Diaz, who took time off this afternoon. Chris Young, who's back in the studios there. Jacob, who's there. Emily from Wordsworth Books. Colleen Fitzpatrick. Tammy Bender. Is she here? No, very smart. She didn't show up. And Aaron Baxter, and of course, Fred Kuntz and Tad Homer-Dixon. I want to thank them all. They've done an amazing job to bring me home, bring me here. They've done great work. And I kind of want to acknowledge them. Can you guys just clap now? Thank you, guys. Thank you. I kind of want to do that now. I don't want to wait till the end of the speech when you realize what crap I'm going to do. And then you'd be like, why did you bring that guy? Come on, I mean, let's do better next time. Okay, I've got PowerPoint presentation. I got a couple of videos to show you, but I'm pretty challenged with PowerPoint. So let me show you in an interactive way what we're talking about here. Jacob, you're gonna hate me for this, but I'm now gonna jump into the audience. This room is now gonna be an interactive PowerPoint presentation, okay? And that wall over there is 100%. And the wall back here, near this very glamorously dressed woman, hello, I'm Declan.
Hello, nice to meet you.
Nice to meet you, yes. Right, just behind, sorry, what was your name?
Chris.
Just behind Chris, the glamorously dressed woman, is zero. And from zero to 100 is the world of sports gambling. I'm going to show you how the world of sports gambling is organized in January 2015, okay? This is total global world market. So let me start here. Hello.
Hello.
I'm Declan, hi.
I'm Benoit.
Nice to meet you, Benoit. Hey, good to meet you. Right. So, Benoit, just make sure I'm honest here, okay? I am now going to show you, we'll start with something that everybody knows, Las Vegas. I'm going to show you Las Vegas's share of the total world sports gambling market. Okay, everyone ready? Benoit, you ready? Chris? Ready? Okay. Did you see that? Okay, Chris, did you see that? Okay, let's do that again. Okay, ready? Just watch my feet. Okay, this is Las Vegas's share of the total global sports gambling market. Right, you saw that. It's comparatively small. It's maybe grossing 20 to 30 million. Las Vegas casinos use sports gambling as a way of bringing in other people and other punters. But the Sports Vegas book is basically dead. It's all gone offshore. Let's say North American gambling, either offshore in the Caribbean or Costa Rica, or even the guys like Michael Francis, his successors, they have about this amount of the world. Let's bring in the legitimate legal guys in Britain, like Paddy Power and the new betting exchanges like Betfair, William Hill, Ladbrokes. Let's even bring in Ontario Lottery Gaming, all the World Lottery Associations, which are the government-run gambling associations, you know, be it in Chile or Sweden or wherever. All of that, all the European, North American, African, it's quite small in Africa, and Latin America is this, from here to where Benoit and Chris are, maybe 25 to 30%. The rest, here, all of this, right past these guys, all this, up to here, Asian sports gambling market. Let me give you a specific example of the power of that market that I just walked through. Has anyone here, let's put your hands up please, has anyone here heard of a company called Adidas or Adidas? Has anyone here heard of a company called IBC Bet? IBC Bet grosses conservatively 4 to 5 times as much money as Adidas does. One sports bookmaking company based in Manila, Philippines. They gross somewhere between $44 and $48 billion a year. Adidas does somewhere between 9 and 10. Now, I don't want to be accused of exaggeration. The way the profit margins for a sports clothing company and a gambling company are different. So I'm not suggesting that IBC is as profitable, but I am saying that they're much, much bigger. I have a fair amount of knowledge about IBC Bet because I was there last year. One of their chief bookmakers has become a contact and a friend. And so they brought me in for the first time past their 6 Rolls Royces, up into a vast trading floor where hundreds of traders were going on. There were about 75 semi-naked women in bikinis and lingerie because they were running a casino in the other room. And they had a large shark tank in the middle. And Pekingese Chihuahua dogs running around this place. And it was a slow night. It was a really slow night. It was one of those nights where East Asia, so Hong Kong and those areas in Manila, were being hit by a small typhoon. So most sporting events were off the books. And it was Friday night, and there was one game that was on. And that was a game between the under-16 team of Hong Kong, so 15-year-olds, and the under-16 team of Macau, so 15-year-olds. And they were playing on a Friday night. There was $5 million U.S. dollars on that one game of 15-year-olds. Let me give you a sense of what that room is that I've walked through. There's a fair amount of exaggeration and embellishment when people talk about the sports gambling world, in the same way that people embellish how big the Mexican drug cartels are. Until they open your books, we don't know. We can't tell in total how much that walk that I did from Benoit and Chris's area to here is. But let me give you just a couple of ideas. The lowest that we have is $93 billion. By the head of World Lottery Association, which is the government-run lotteries around the world. The private bookmakers from William Hill and Ladbrokes came out with a study in European Union which estimated it somewhere around $323 billion. Interpol estimates it at somewhere around $500 billion. A contact of mine at the Hong Kong Jockey Club, which is the world's biggest government-run sports gambling company, in Hong Kong, an institution that's almost impossible to overstate how much impact it has on Hong Kong's cultural life. He and I were talking last spring, and he said, you know, FIFA, the World Soccer Organization, talks about FIFA bringing $4 billion in revenue around the World Cup. Out here, we have a name for the day where $4 billion is generated in one day. We call it Thursday. He estimated the market is $1 trillion. I don't know. And I refuse to make any attempts to try to gauge exactly how big it is, because I can't tell. I can't see until I do a forensic audit of people's books. I can't tell. But we know that room that I've walked through is somewhere between 93 billion and 1 trillion. So what does that mean? Well, much of that 1 trillion potential audience, $93 billion market, is run by criminals. It's run by the Asian equivalent of Al Capone. And what that has done is it's ruined most Asian sports. There are a few honorable exceptions to Asian sports, a few. Let me pull in a sport out of the top of my head. Japanese sumo wrestling. Now, one of my new friends, tell me your name, love, with the scarf. I'm just trying to keep you awake. You looked about to doze off there. Yeah. Susan, nice to meet you, Susan. Well, Susan, you're obviously an expert in Japanese sport, and you will know that the history of sumo wrestling is shrouded in debate and controversy. And some people say that it's 900 years old. Other people say that it's only 300 years old. But what nobody doubts is that there's a national championship that is held every year in Osaka. And that championship, Suzanne, has been stopped twice in the multi-hundreds of year history. Once was in 1946. And I don't think I have to explain much to the people in this room as to why it would have been stopped in 1946. The American Air Force had leveled and devastated most Japanese cities. The country was on its knees. It was in devastation, ruins, threat of starvation. So the Japanese Sumo Wrestling Association at that time just said, you know what, it's just not appropriate for us to hold a sumo wrestling championship. The second time in those multiple hundreds of years that the sumo wrestling championship has been stopped was in 2011, when colleagues, Japanese colleagues and investigative journalists in Japan got hold of the texts, the telephone texts between what is known as the Yakuza, or the Japanese mafia, and key Japanese wrestlers and owners of sumo wrestling stables and coaches. And they discovered such an extensive network of corruption and fixing in sumo wrestling that the Japanese Sumo Wrestling Association, for the second time in its history, said, you know what, it's not worth it. We will not have any credibility with a national championship. We have to suspend this. So I want you to hold in your mind that image of a devastated landscape, because that is sports in Asia now. That statement may sound a bit hyperbole. Might sound slightly culturally insensitive. But I beg you, go check on the internet. Go check everything that I'm going to say to you this evening. If there's anything that you think I've stepped over the lines, go check. Go look at Taiwanese baseball, which started with 13 teams in 1991. It's now down to 4. 9 of those teams kicked out because of match fixing. Go check South Korean soccer, where there have been 4 suicides of young players linked to it and over 55 arrests. Check out South Korean motorboat racing. Check out South Korean baseball. Check out South Korean e-sports games. You know this new thing where you have a bunch of geeky guys playing another bunch of geeky guys on computer games, and a bunch of geeky people watch them? They fix that. No, I'm serious. Like, it sounds like a joke, but it's not. Chinese soccer is a national embarrassment. That's not the words of Declan Hill. That's the words of the former Chinese premier. Chinese soccer, it's very difficult not to get an audience for something in China. The population, the demographics of that country, the demand for sporting culture is so much. But you can go to a Chinese soccer game and be in an empty stadium. Because in the words of the Chinese leaders, it's a national embarrassment. There's so much corruption. There's so much fixing going on. They arrested over 200 people in China, from the president of the Chinese Soccer Association all the way down to the guys who cleaned their boots, players, coaches, team owners, referees. They appointed another guy in there 6 months later, I had to come in and arrest the guy that they put in. If it was just Chinese soccer in South Korea and Japan and Taiwan, but it's the same thing as in Singapore, in Vietnam, in Malaysia, in Cambodia, in Indonesia. Actually, this is funny, okay? This will be my last story about this section. Indonesia is a very corrupt country. It's very difficult to get arrested for corruption in Indonesia. And by the way, I'm not saying anything that any Indonesian wouldn't say. The head of the Indonesian Soccer Association wasn't just alleged to be corrupt, he was actually arrested for corruption. He wasn't just arrested for corruption, he was put on trial for corruption, which is really rare in Indonesia. He wasn't just put on trial, he was convicted and sentenced to 2 years in jail for corruption in Indonesia. He wasn't just sentenced, they actually took him off to jail and put him in jail for 2 years for corruption. Now, at no point in this time did they ever stop being the president of the Indonesian Soccer Association. He ran the association from his jail cell. Look, I can go on and on and about corruption in Asian sports linked to this gambling market, linked to this huge gambling market. But my task tonight is not to pick on Asian sports. There are a few honorable exceptions that are not corrupt, but most of it is an elephant's graveyard of corruption. So what is the average Asian sports fan doing? They're switching off their local sports. They're no longer going. The sponsorship's dying up, the attendance are dying up. They're just saying, you know what? It's not worth our time. We're not gonna be made fools of by watching this nonsense. We're gonna start looking at other sports around the world. And that's part of the reason why when you walk down a street in Beijing, you'll see, part of the reason, you'll see Houston Rockets shirts, obviously, and Manchester United shirts and other shirts. People are now watching other sports around the world. What is also happening is that massive gambling market, the one that I walked through from Benoit and Chris at the back there, that massive gambling market is stopping betting on Asian sports, and they've discovered a whole new world of stuff to bet on. So they're coming to Europe. They're coming to North America. They're coming to Latin America, and they're fixing sports. Let me tell you about the Southeast Asian Games. Southeast Asian Games are like a Pan-American Games. They're like a mini-Olympics of the countries in Southeast Asia. And by the way, this is absolutely true. It's going to sound as if it's not, but it is absolutely true. The Vietnamese press, in the fall of 2006, the Vietnamese journalists were worried that the Vietnamese team wouldn't do well in the upcoming Southeast Asian Games in the Philippines. So at a press conference with the chargé d'affaires, the guy, the administrative official in charge of the Vietnamese team, they said, we don't think we're going to do very well. By the way, sorry, you're now the Vietnamese chargé d'affaires, okay? Tell me your name, sir. Paul, okay, thank you, Paul, for stepping in and things in short notice. So Paul, the Vietnamese chargé d'affaires, I'm not making this up, I really am not, goes, don't worry, we fixed everything. And we've had meetings with all the chargé d'affaires, and the Philippines, because they're having a presidential election, and that's where the games are being hosted, they're going to win the most medals, and he explained which medals they would win. And Singapore, which is the country where a lot of the companies that sponsored it are in, they're going to win the second amount, but we, the Vietnamese, are going to win the third most number of medals. So the Vietnamese journalists displayed all the kind of courage that you would expect from journalists in a communist country, and they did not report it. However, there was a stringer from Agence France-Presse, a young woman who didn't get on message. And she wrote this up, and it went across the wires. And Filipino journalists have many problems, but lack of courage is not one of them. And they love this story. It splashed all over the front pages of the Filipino newspapers. Southeast Asian Games next week will be fixed. Here's the chart. This is what's going to do it. Thaksin Shinawat, the former prime minister now exiled from Thailand, was asked at a press conference. This is the prime minister of a country. Said, we have this story that the Southeast Asian Games next week will be fixed. What do you think, Mr. Shinawat? And the prime minister says, you know what? They're right. Everyone knows the Southeast Asian Games are fixed all the time. We should just abolish them and start again. So the games take place, and at the end of the games, two things happen. The Vietnamese team flies back, and at the airport, they're met by the Vietnamese police that arrest nine of their national soccer team for fixing games there. And two, the Filipino journalists splash all over their pages again that the predictions that Paul, the chargé d'affaires, made and the actual things were completely accurate. Completely accurate. So, large Asian sports gambling market, fixing much of Asian sport. Most Asian sports fans are now turning their attention away and are looking at other sports. The fixers that fixed Asian sports are now traveling around the world. How are they operating? How are they working? Well, what they're doing is they're linking up with local criminals in countries, and they're forming kind of marriages of convenience, international networks of corruption. And what the Europeans or North American criminals are doing is they are fixing the players and the games and the referees or the team officials here. And these guys are fixing the gambling market. They're making sure that the bets on these fixed games are going onto the market and nobody can tell. They're disguising them. They're hiding them. They're using all kinds of devices to do that. Again, in a presentation that has kind of batted most ordinary, regular, moderate commentary well out of the park, that's another comment that I'm making. That maybe Susan and Paul and Benoit and everyone are thinking, well, how does he know this? Like, how do I know this? Like, what is the basis of what I'm talking about? And I want to stress that when I make these kind of statements and these kind of remarks, this is based on the firmest evidence that you can have in a Western society. This is judicial evidence that has gone from arrests by police all the way through to a court conviction. As part of my methodology, both as an investigative journalist but also as an investigative academic, I've collected tens of thousands of these pages and analyzed the names, collecting the databases, seen what we have, seen the networks of these guys. We have their photos. We have their addresses. We know where they live. We know all of their activities that they've done. So we're talking about marriages of convenience, and we're talking that we know because of a whole series of court decisions and tens of thousands of pages of documentation about these networks around the world. There's really no secret as to the identity of a number of the low-level fixers, the guys that have actually got on planes and gone and made these arrangements, gone and made these deals. The most notorious case is the case of Dan Tan, or Tan Sit Ng in Singapore, a gentleman who I saw a number of times in Singapore when I was doing my research, approaching the Ghanaian assistant goalkeeping coach and arranging a fix there. His network, and again, we have the documentation on this, is in Guatemala, where they just arrested and suspended 30 of their national team players. Honduras, El Salvador, where similar numbers of people were there. Peru, where the team was operating. Ecuador, Egypt, where they were actually running soccer tournaments. South Africa, where they had officials on the payroll. Zimbabwe, where they basically ran the soccer association. Ivory Coast, Ghana, Sierra Leone, which has caused a political scandal there. Greece, again, another investigation involving over 100 people. Turkey, where it just goes on and on in Turkey. Italy, where over 20 of their professional soccer teams are now under investigation for fixing. There's only about 80 of them, so one in four of Italian professional soccer teams are now under investigation for fixing. Over 40 of them are investigation for criminal money laundering. Austria, Germany, Norway, Sweden, Finland, Belgium, the Netherlands, Germany, and Canada. They arranged fixed games in the Canadian Soccer League. Without question, I have no problem, no hesitation saying that. There's a court trial in Germany where the match fixers stand up, confess to it, the judge says, we believe them. They have the documentation. And the network worked in the following way. Dan Tan and the Singaporeans fixed the gambling market. Croatian fixers called Ante and Milan Sapina, also gentlemen that I've met and interviewed, in Berlin, work through another guy, another Croatian mobster in Nuremberg, who had connections in a Croatian team here in Ontario. And they were fixing games here. The sports gambling monitoring companies are still pulling up Canadian games that are fixed. One of my other hats that I wear is to be an international expert. I go around, I testify before Parliament or International Olympic Committees or UEFA or various soccer associations that are purportedly fighting against this. I'm very skeptical of the official response from FIFA and Interpol, and I've said this many times. I don't think that they're doing an adequate job to protect themselves. The head of Interpol, or the former head of Interpol, loves to start his conferences and says, you know what the worst country in the world is, the most unrecognized country in the world for sports match fixing? Canada. And I have to say he's right. You know, we have these fixes going on in our Canadian Soccer League, in our games here, and no one is doing anything about it. It's extraordinary. The German investigator, the chief German investigator, a guy who has a room full of files, a conviction in a court with a network in at least 9 different countries, said to me, we had 9 different countries involved in this network. 8 of the national police agencies came and worked with me. The one exception, Canada. Our people are letting us down. Now, there are, I'm sure, hockey fans in this room who are sitting there going, well, that's very interesting, but it's soccer. What do you expect? Those guys flop on their legs every time somebody runs past them. So let's talk a little bit about the sports that have been touched by match fixing. What is the easiest sport in the world to fix? The gentleman in the maroon t-shirt. Just there. Yes, you, sir. Yeah, the one who's turning away. I know you've got a guilty conscience, sir. What do you think is the most easy sport in the world to fix? Sir? Any idea? No, the gentleman 2 rows in front of you, who's looking completely stony-faced, like, oh my goodness. I don't know if it's a maroon or a red shirt. Yes, you, sir, yes. You want to fix a boxing match? Come on up here. No, I'm serious. Come on up. Right. Anyone understand why he might be hesitating? Because one of us is going to have to take a punch. Right? Hello.
Hello.
I'm Declan. Hi. Thanks for coming up and helping me.
I'm Steve.
Great, Steve. I wish I'd picked a smaller man. Right, Steve and I will demonstrate, not actually a boxing match, but we will stand here like this and say, we're now going to fix this game. I don't think so, because Steve is going to hit me, and I'm going to hurt. So what would be a better game for Steve and me to fix? Yes, sir. Ma'am. Sir. Golf. I have not heard anything about golf. You might be right. It might be the easiest game. But I have not heard anything, and I don't want to risk my credibility by talking about a sport. Thanks. Sir.
Tennis.
Thank you. Stephen and I will now fix a tennis game. Look, it's much easier. Stephen's not going to hit me. I'm great. I'm like cool with that. We bat the ball back and forth, and in the middle of the second set, I'm like, oh, Steve, oh, I'm so sorry. I'd love to carry on with you. But I pulled my hamstring. Game to him, money to me. Steve, can I get a round of applause for Steve for having the courage? Thank you very much. Tennis has a massive problem. Massive problem with this. And it's not the top 20 players in the world. They get lots and lots of money, both in sponsorship deal. But once you're outside of that top 20, 30 places in ATP tennis, the earnings drop is extraordinary. This has been a renowned problem in sport, in tennis. And ATP, fair enough, has accepted that they have a problem and is starting to put in all kinds of integrity measures and all kinds of, quote, education problems. Table tennis has a problem. Badminton has a problem. And when I say they have a problem, it means that they've been fixing games either in Europe or in North America. Czech junior hockey has a problem. Czech junior hockey has a naturally occurring problem if you set aside morality. Czech junior hockey owners of teams, and this is, you know, court decision in Czech Republic, were caught saying, we're playing 60 games a year as a hockey team. We're going to try to win these 50 games, but we're deliberately going to lose these 10 games. We're going to gamble against ourselves on the sports gambling market, and we'll make more money from losing those 10 games than we will from winning the other 50. I don't want to suggest that Canadian hockey right now has a match-fixing problem or a sports corruption problem. I'm not suggesting that. I'm not risking my credibility to suggest that. What I am saying is, what in heck's name do Canadians think is preventing fixing to come into our national sport? Is there, for example, an international anti-corruption agency here in Canada? Is there a specially designated police force to deal with this, like they have in Australia? Is there legislation before our parliaments, either federal or provincial, to deal with this? Is there any sports leader anywhere in the country discussing this, as Thomas Bach, the head of the International Olympic Committee, is doing? Sports around the world, from Asia to Europe to Latin America, soccer in Canada is being seen as being fixed and is full of corruption. So my question is, when are we going to get off our asses as a nation and start defending our sport? The time to build defenses is before the people come, before the invaders come. I stand before you not as an academic, and now not as a journalist, but as a man who's risked his life to uncover and try to protect sport. Sport has given me some of the best friendships of my life. It's given me some of the best moments of my life. And I don't think I'm alone in this room when I say that. I appeal to you. I urge you. We can defend sport. We can protect Canadian sport right now so that our children get this vessel where we can teach them our dreams, our hopes, our visions, our ideals. And so I urge you, please join me in that fight. Thank you for all your patience today with the technology. Thank you, guys. I may do. I may pull up some slides and stuff.
Well, maybe in response to my questions. Why don't we bring up the deck, and then you can go to a particular slide if there's one that's relevant to the questions.
Sure.
Okay. Good. So if we can just have the first slide of the deck, that would be great. Is that the first slide?
Yep.
Great. Well, this is an incredibly interesting topic, and so I have so many questions I could ask. I don't really know where to start, but just dive in as a way of beginning the conversation. It strikes me that there are two parts to this problem. One is there's kind of deep human urge to gamble, and that's universal. I mean, we have a casino outside of Elora, of all places, and it's packed all the time, right? And then there's the match-fixing problem. Now, you could decriminalize gambling on sport everywhere. In some places, it's decriminalized, from what you were saying. But that might not fix the match-fixing problem. So it strikes me that the root of the problem is not so much the gambling, it's the fixing. And there's so much money riding on the gambling that even steering a small portion of it towards the players is going to result in fixing. It's going to be an enormous incentive to fix. So in thinking about this, I don't even really know where the solution lies ultimately. You know, you can think of the stock market as a gambling operation for a lot of folks who don't really know what they're doing, and there's a kind of gambling on the stock market. But the fixing is dealt with by very severe government regulations and serious penalties if somebody is manipulating stock prices or cooking the books in a company or something like that, which would be roughly the equivalent. And here it seems that that it's much more difficult to track down, identify, and pursue and penalize the people who are involved in fixing than it is in, say, the corporate world when you're dealing with the stock market. So where do you see the answer to this if you were going to try to
work with me? Right. Everyone see this list of names? Jacob, come on. Is this working? Right. There's a photo of their money man. This is a diagram drawn by one of the fixers when he's in jail, arrested in Finland. This is a photo of one of the guys. We have his address back in China where he is. This is Wilson Raj Paramel, who's under open arrest in Budapest. This is the man that I was talking about before, Dan Tan, or Tan Seat Inc. He's in detention as a, quote, terrorist in Singapore, but they won't put him on trial. The reason why I say that, Tat, is that it's not like we don't know who's in this network. But the guys that have constructed this network that I'm just going to go through real quickly here, from Singapore around across the world, these guys are not mysterious. They have fixed all these games in all these different countries, and they've got almost no, by the way, that's Canada, South Africa, Zimbabwe, where they ran the things. I just want to pull one particular slide up to illustrate the nature of the very specific problem. These are all countries where we know they have, and again, when I say no, we have judicial evidence that these guys have been involved in fixing in these countries. This takes quite a long time. Switzerland, Slovenia, Croatia, Bulgaria, Netherlands, Romania, Belgium, Malaysia, China, Australia. Oh dear, there we go. That's the chart. That's the chart, Tad, of almost the guys that ran this have never testified in court publicly. And you can't tell me or any of the members of the audience here that they didn't construct this network without senior sports officials being involved. And so we've got to name and shame those senior sports officials, and we've got to arrest and convict at least a couple of them. That would be a really good way of starting to eliminate fixing, and that hasn't been done.
So the first question then would be, you know, the profits are so enormous, potential profits are so enormous. You're talking about hundreds of billions of dollars going through this, these markets, that wouldn't other people simply just fill the void if you shut down these folks? And then the second question is, you've got, you know, in the context of what we're doing in this institution, you've got a global governance problem, right? So there's no, where do you take this? I suppose to Interpol, but the institutions that could, that have the global span and reach and the penetration into societies to actually pick these people up and make sure they're convicted and tried are ultimately national institutions, and you have a lowest common denominator problem there. So those would be the two responses I have.
Except that we know who these guys are. We've got them. In one case with Dantan and Wilson Raj Paramal, they're actually already in detention. What they haven't been is ever been put on a public trial so they can name their officials. I think you're absolutely right. This is a problem that will continue, but it will continue in a much diminished way if we can actually arrest and convict any sports official for doing it.
So you go after the sports officials and in the sports federations. And then ultimately, the players who are actually receiving the money, I mean, maybe some of the sports officials are too, but the players who are receiving the money are not a target of attention in terms of policing and trying to deal with the problem. You go after the officials and the federations instead.
Right now, what they're doing is they're targeting the players. And I would suggest a great way of stopping high-level games from being fixed is to pay the players. And it's an extraordinary fact, but there are players at the World Cup of Soccer, which is the world's biggest sporting tournament, with billions of dollars in sponsorship, with a TV audience around the world, full stadiums, and there are players running onto the field that don't get paid for being there. The most notorious case was Ghana in the last Brazil World Cup of 2014. They weren't being paid so badly that they went on a national strike in the middle of the tournament and said, you know what, we're not going to pay to play our last game until we get our salary flown in from Ghana. So the president of their country had to charter a plane, fly X million bullion across the thing to pay these guys.
But you're not going to be paying 15-year-olds in Hong Kong. I mean, there's such an insatiable demand for an object of gambling, something to bet on, that I don't. Your answer, go after the sports officials, seems to be a much more solid answer, because in the urge to gamble and the international network that you're talking about is so, these things are so extraordinarily strong that they're going to find things to gamble on somewhere. And there'll be an enormous amount of money behind that.
Look, I think there are two very good points. One is, will this network continue? Will this criminality continue? And I will say, of course it will continue. It's continuing now because they haven't arrested the people who have helped put this network together. They've gone, as you said, for the lowest common denominator. They've gone for the players rather than for the senior people. And senior people, if we can backtrack a little in these things, I won't bother because we're having such technical problems, but there's senior amounts of protection that this network has received. We just have to put one of those senior people on, and the embarrassment factor will be so severe that at least it will give a deterrent effect to it. I think the other point is extremely accurate, and that is that there's a difference between gambling and fixing. And gambling is something that people have always done. For the Christians in the audience, when Christ was being crucified, the Roman soldiers were rolling dice and gambling underneath his cross. So gambling has always been around in humanity. But fixing, and this widespread fixing of sports games, has not been. And we can eliminate the second.
Okay, so to pursue this point about solutions, over dinner, we talked about the IOC a bit, mm-hmm. and you said that the IOC has actually substantially cleaned up its act. And I guess Dick Pound was instrumental in that. So are there some lessons there in what was done to clean up the Olympics movement that can be employed elsewhere in other parts of sports around the world?
Again, I'm sorry to come back to our red herring here, but the sports officials in FIFA are sometimes involved with the fixing. So I'm not suggesting that Sepp Blatter or his acolytes and his administrative staff in Switzerland are involved with fixing, but certainly some of the national soccer associations that vote for Blatter. Blatter is the president of the FIFA. He's the top man in FIFA. And he's elected by national soccer associations around the world. And the story that I did in the New York Times with Jere Longman just before the start of the last World Cup showed that just before the start of the South African World Cup in 2010, there were officials inside the South African Association, the same guys that were putting on the tournament, that were working with these guys, were working with the match fixers. So if you have that kind of systemic problem inside FIFA, you've got a real problem.
Something else you mentioned over dinner that I'd really like to get across to the audience and struck me is that, and it came across in your presentation this evening, but I want to push it a bit, is that this whole enterprise is kind of parasitical on the perceived legitimacy of the matches. Mm-hmm. And if they aren't perceived to be legitimate, then people just don't attend the matches and the whole thing starts to implode. You don't have the object of on which you can sort of focus your gambling enterprise anymore. You have to have that thing that you're gambling about. And if that isn't perceived to be legitimate, then the audiences don't attend, the teams fold, and all of a sudden you can't gamble on them anymore. So you said during dinner, which is something I found very interesting, that what delegitimizes sporting enterprises more than anything else is the perception that people are intentionally losing, players are intentionally losing. And maybe you could just elaborate on that a bit, because what you said over dinner was interesting about people, players who are taking steroids and cheating to win are not as disparaged or held in such negative light as players who are cheating to lose.
Yeah.
And this may be actually a really important way into dealing with the problem, because if the sports become delegitimized, people know that matches are being fixed and some people on one side or the other are being paid to lose and are intentionally losing, as you did in your little skit up here, then that's going to make the public more generally angry about what's going on, and that will help deal with the problem in some general sense.
Two points. First one, Lance Armstrong and Ben Johnson will eventually be rehabilitated. Because what they were doing was they were cheating to win. They were really desperately trying to win their tournament and their event and the Tour de France. And so were most people around them. What I'm talking about is cheating to lose, which is an unforgivable sin in terms of sports. People will not have that. They absolutely will not have that. And I have an entire chapter on that in the second book, the academic one, which is more about definitions. Here's a second point, Tad. I'm sorry, this is a total non sequitur, but is Ben Rycroft here? I wonder if, Ben, if you could just stand up. And I realize that I, in my technological challenge here, I didn't have. Ben Rycroft is a hero. Only in Canada could his name not be a household name. Ben Rycroft was a sports journalist. He interviewed me in 2009. He became intrigued with what I was saying about Canadian soccer, and he took it upon himself to expose the widespread corruption in Canadian Soccer League. He received a number of death threats for it by Croatian mobsters in Toronto. Keep standing up. Can we give this man a round of applause? I'm sorry, Ben. I should have mentioned you during the speech. Thank you so much for your honor of coming to this meeting.
So can we leverage that legitimacy issue in some way we can say to Canadian sports officials and Canadian governmental officials and policymakers, look at all the stadiums in China, they're empty now. Nobody will go to matches because nobody believes these things are real anymore. Do we want that to happen here? I mean, to the extent that journalists reveal that there's fixing going on to lose, that people are cheating to lose, then it starts to gut that particular sporting enterprise.
Absolutely, and I think the other thing that we can do, Tad, is point out Australia. I mean, the Australians have taken this on board. They've set up a national police agency specifically to deal with sports corruption on all levels. They've got anti-corruption hotlines. So if an athlete is approached to fix a game, be it a 17-year-old at a cricket match in Melbourne or a 32-year-old rugby rules player, and I pull those cases up because they were specific cases, they've got a number that they can phone so that they can bypass a potentially corrupt team owner or potentially corrupt coach and report these things anonymously. In Canada, we unfortunately are light years away from even beginning the discussion, let alone having those kind of things that the Australians have.
And that's worked in Australia.
The Australians are extremely proud of their sporting legacy, and they're absolutely going the country mile to defend it.
So I have one last question before we turn to the audience, and that is a lot of folks might say, well, this is a problem, clearly, but it's in the sporting world. Mm. And what's the general problem here? Does it really matter? I mean, is there any implication that there could be a spillover effect into, say, broader social mores or causing corruption in other parts of society? Or is, to the extent that this happens, is it really isolated and containable within just sporting communities?
In my opinion, I don't want to undersell myself, but I think it's contained in sport. But for me, as a guy that loves sport, that's enough. Like, I don't want to lose sport. I don't want Canadian sport. Now, if a Chinese parent has a son or daughter in sports, that's kind of seen in the same way that proficiency in pool used to be in when I was growing up. If you were really good at pool, it was a sign of a misspent youth. You know, you'd be hanging out with the bad guys. The same thing is now if you're a good athlete in China. You're considered a bit of a dubious character because of this. And that's not what it should be. I don't think sports should be that way.
It's also true, though, that all this money pouring through various criminal organizations, you've mentioned some communities in Canada, for instance, helps develop the social capital and the networks within those communities that can then get into a lot of other stuff beyond sports. So there may be, it's conceivable that there could be substantial spillover effects from mm-hmm. this corruption in one part of the society. But let's turn now to the audience, and I don't know exactly how this is going to work. Do people have to go to microphones? A microphone here and a microphone there. So if you could just introduce yourself quickly. And Fred, I'm going to require signal at some point.
I got out of fighting Stephen. I'm not going to fight anyone else. I'm sorry, guys.
Hi, my name's Luke. I'm a student here at the Ball City School in the Masters of International Public Policy program. I used to manage a PDL team here in Ontario. And that's a development league for soccer. And the CSL is also a development league. And my players would always talk about how corrupt the CSL was, and it was almost always a given. The difference between my players and their players was CSL teams had no real future prospects. They didn't have any resilience to the lures of gambling. Dr. Homer Dixon mentioned earlier, you can't pay 15-year-olds in Hong Kong not to cheat. But we do that in Canada with junior hockey players. Every player that plays a year for the Kitchener Rangers is going to get 1 year tuition and books to a Canadian university that they get into. My question is, there are some players that have no resilience. There's some players that do. And as far as I know, Canadian hockey leagues haven't received the influx of corruption and bribery. What are the characteristics of sports leagues or players or sports in general that have been resilient to match fixing? And what can leagues that are trying to protect themselves from it institute in order, like at a league level, at a player level, at an incentive level, to sort of rebuff the efforts of all these Asian mobsters?
I think, I just want to unpack what you said, Luke. I would start by suggesting you take a look at Canadian junior hockey again. I don't think that there's fixing going on in, I'm not trying to lose my credibility here, I'm not saying that, but my sense from a number of my colleagues is that labor conditions in Canadian junior hockey are not quite as rosy as you say they are. I'll leave that out there, and I'm not suggesting that they're leading to corruption, but I have a feeling you might be on the wrong track there with your characterization of Canadian junior hockey. But it's an excellent question. What can good leagues do to prevent themselves from doing bad leagues? And I have an entire chapter in my academic book on exactly that. There's a number of things that they can do. One is something called tournament incentives. There used to be a tournament incentive in the NBA that the more games you lost, the better your draft pick was the next year. Hello? So what do you think happened to the teams after a threshold point in the season when they knew they weren't going to make the playoffs? So by making small alterations like that, you can disincentivize teams from fixing. And that's actually quite an easy thing to do. Two, you can honor your playing contracts. Your implication that Canadian junior hockey is free from exploitation of players, I think might be wrong. I think, I'm not an expert. But certainly the less exploitation of players that goes on in the league, the better it is. There's a great source book, if you have a chance of, you know, you can download it on the internet, called The Black Book. It came out in February of 2012, it was put out by the Players Union, and it examined soccer players' conditions in various European countries. In fact, it was so bad in Greece and Turkey, the Players Union was advising their athletes, don't play in Greece and Turkey. Well, you can guess how bad corruption and fixing is in the Greek and Turkish league from that.
One of the things we know about corruption around the world is, it doesn't matter whether it's in Georgia, in the Caucasus, or in urban areas in the United States, with, for instance, police forces, is you got to pay your cops, right?
Yep.
To reduce corruption. You've got to pay your civil servants effectively to reduce corruption. I kind of found the idea that you could provide hockey scholarships to young players instead of paying them directly, because then if there are any shenanigans, you can take away those perks.
And yeah, that's, I think it's an excellent idea. I'm not sure if always those scholarships come into play. I've seen a number of articles and talked to a number of labor officials, but I'm not sure about that.
Let's go over here. And by the way, I should say, I don't have anything on the screen, so if people are trying to tap in email questions, there's nothing here.
Okay, I'm Steve. I'm just a resident of Waterloo.
Hey, Steve.
I have a question. It's not related to what was just discussed, but and you might not be able to answer it based on the variance you pointed out in the size of potential gambling, but with the large Asian market turning away from their own sports in terms of betting,
yes,
has there been any noticeable decrease in people actually betting in the dollar value being bet because they understand that, you know, these matches are being fixed? What's the point of betting if there is a good enough chance I'm losing money, because most of it's set up, I would believe, so that the body controlling the betting is the one making the money, not the actual person making the bet.
I think there are two variables going in. One is, has the actual rate of gambling gone down in some of these leagues? Yes, but there's still enough that it drives the thing. There's actually now a mini industry in the Asian gambling industry of people providing information about, quote, fixed matches. So you have a multi-billion dollar industry saying, bet this way because it's fixed. And I'm not kidding, guys. You're betting on the fix now. And that's so much so, you know, I wasn't able to get into the techniques of the fixers. But when I was talking about what the fixers do, they'll often spread a rumor across their network that they fixed a game one way. So everyone bets that way, and then they fix the game the other way. The other thing that's coming in, which we haven't talked about, is that Asia's getting richer. And every day that it gets richer, more money flows into the gambling market.
I guess an add-on question is just, if you know what the percentage of the market of betting is, kind of how much wealth they hold. Let's say the top, 3% of the bettors actually hold 75% of the wealth in terms of betting, or if it is more evenly distributed in terms of like how I'm just trying to think of like wealth distribution of the people actually making the bets.
Everyone makes bets. Like it really does. And there's a very useful site that we can talk about off camera and at the end. I'm not allowed to mention these guys' sites because of legal stuff, but they actually, it's very, very useful, and they're totally legal in a lot of jurisdictions. I'm just not sure if they're legal here in Ontario. But they're a UK company, and they actually have the amount of money on each sporting event. So it's very, very useful. Say you're looking at, Canadian badminton. Not suggesting that they're fixing, but you can check how much gambling is going on that sport or that event.
Quick question just to follow up there, because it was alluded to in your exchange. What is it about Asia? I mean, why is this problem seem to originate in Asia? You mentioned the fact that it's getting wealthier fast, but I mean, this is a tricky issue, I suppose, and one has to be a bit delicate, but it's not Russia. It's not, Europe, despite the fact that there's enormous money engaged in sports in Europe. Not Latin America so much. So what's going on with Asia?
I think one of the problems is that gambling, it's a complicated issue, but one of the problems is that gambling is strictly illegal. But it's enormously popular. So it's a little like alcohol in the United States during the 1920s in Prohibition. So when you make something that's incredibly popular illegal, it corrupts and toxifies entire societies, judiciary, police, all kinds of things.
So decriminalizing gambling then is potentially part of the solution.
I think, nationalizing it, as they
have in Hong Kong.
I think in Hong Kong they have less than Malaysia because, and again, we have to be very careful about which country we're speaking about in a vast continent. But most countries on that continent still have a very hard line rule against sports gambling. It's entirely illegal for all kinds of cultural reasons. And so what happens is you have these shadow puppet theaters where the police raid a gambling den, they arrest somebody, they're shown in the paper, but it really doesn't touch the stuff.
Let's go to John in Ottawa here on the screen. I'll just read it for folks in the audience. The thrill of betting is the risk of an unknown outcome and potential reward. Is it merely greed? Is income inequality driving all participants to get involved?
Well, John, thank you for that question. I would return to what Tad's analysis, which I thought was, as usual, brilliant, is there's a difference between gambling and fixing, and there's a difference between corruption and gambling. And really, I think that gambling is part of the solution towards this thing. Again, Tad was talking about you have this vast sports gambling market, there's so much money involved, this is a massive problem. I would say, like Cuban boxers, you make the problem your solution. And you say, yeah, it's a vast gambling market, legalize it and get that money and make them sponsor teams and sports.
Mm-hmm. And pay the players.
And pay the players.
Okay, let's go over here. Giorgos, master's candidate in global governance here at the Balsillie School. First of all, Declan, thank you very much for coming. Being a huge soccer fan, it's an honor to be to have been here tonight and have heard you.
Thanks, brother. Thank you.
The same way you congratulated, I think his name was Ben, I think the work that you've done is beyond brave. Meeting with guys like Dan Tan and Wilson Piramal, I mean, I won't even, like, it's beyond me. That must be scary stuff. So all the credit to you.
Thanks, brother.
Thank you. Wow, where do I start? I have several questions for you. Having read your book, again, I have several things I could ask, but one thing that I find striking, and after reading your book, it almost seems to me like it's too difficult and too complex to solve just because it's permeated all over the place. We're talking hundreds of billions of dollars for some of these mobsters in Asia. That gives them the leverage to get police on their side, to get all sorts of people on their side. And even in cases like Italy, with Silvio Berlusconi at Milan and the Agnelli family, these are people who are pretty high up in society. So I think tackling the problem, I mean, it's almost like, where do you begin when you're dealing with people that are this important and this much wealth and power associated to them?
Let me stop you right there. Nothing I've ever seen suggesting that Berlusconi or Agnelli have been involved in fixing or corruption. As you know from reading my first book, I met a bunch of fixers and a guy named Abu Karadamba, who's the goalkeeping coach of the Ghana team, in a Kentucky Fried Chicken in, actually it was in Singapore, and the book I say was Thailand, but it was actually Singapore, Northern Sambawang. And I taped that conversation, and I took photos of the guys together. And what they were discussing was how they were going to put together an attempted fix of the World Cup game. And the characters that they mentioned, and I'm not going to mention their names. I have no idea if they're true or not. Fixers, a guy who was later arrested for fixing in Ghana, were saying, we now have to raise $1 million to pull this fix off. We are going to go and visit this prominent person. I would suggest that all we have to do is get one of those, quote, prominent people, put him on trial, and there's a disincentive in future for these prominent people to provide protection and money and do this kind of thing. People will come to them, the fixers will come to them, and they're like, hey, whoa, I'm not gonna do that, it's just not worth my time. Yes, I'll run a legal gambling operation, yes, I'll make money that way, but I don't wanna get involved in fixing. And I'm sorry, I wanted to stop you about Berlusconi and Agnelli, because I don't wanna say anything either false or legally actionable, and I've never seen anything to suggest those were
shady. I mean, Juventus was relegated a couple of years back because
That was Moji. That was Moji, their general manager, was doing it, and there was no indication that it came from the thing upstairs.
So, do you have a question? You said you had several, so...
I'll just leave it at that.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Again, I want everyone in the audience to... both online and offline, both here in the audience tonight, to remember the name of Ben Rycroft. Ben really broke this story. Because I'm connected with the German guys, I talked about it a lot, but Ben, your man in the audience, actually, expended shoe leather and went and investigated this stuff. Here's what I know from the German guys, was that there was a network, starting with Tan and his associates in Singapore. They went to the guys in Berlin, again, in the book, in the first book, you'll see that I meet with the Sapina brothers. They're meeting a Croatian mobster based in Nuremberg who I think has just gone to jail. And all these guys have been detained now. And they had links in with the Toronto Croatia team. And I'm not suggesting the entire Toronto Croatia team was on the fix, but they certainly had players that were working in on the fix, and they fixed one of the games there. Ben, is that right? Anything you want to add?
No, I'll let you do your speech.
What? Your courage has deserted you on this one, Ben? Come on, brother. Actually, no, I'm sorry. I shouldn't make a joke about your courage in any ways. And I'm not suggesting every team in the Canadian Soccer League was involved in fixing, nor am I suggesting that all the players or all the referees, but I wish you were the first Canadian Soccer League player that I've talked to who said similar things. And this is the problem, is that fixing taints and toxifies everyone involved in a league and everybody involved in a team. And that's why we need to remove this stuff. That's why we need to fight against it.
What really struck me in this presentation and in the conversation over dinner is the reach of this money, of this capital from Asia, people looking for an object for their gambling, and how that can... they don't know anything about Canada. They don't know anything about our sports. They don't know anything about the CSL. But it's a game, and you can bet on it. And that becomes the place where you go. You mentioned this point, which is really important, about the fact that we play our games through a portion of the year when Asian sports is not available. So you might just want to elaborate on that. Yeah, it's one reason that Canada is really interesting to these folks.
Part of the reason why the Canadian Soccer League has been so prominent in the fixing scandals. And part of the reason why the Tivoli Cup in Denmark, which is an under 18 tournament, was targeted for gambling, was that they occurred during the summer months. And the gambling market, that enormous market, runs 365, 24/7. And come the end of Serie A, the first week of June, to middle of August, they don't have anything to gamble on. So they turn their attention to these leagues, these summer leagues, where they normally would ignore. They wouldn't pay much attention to the Canadians if all the European leagues were in operation at the same time. But that gambling market is now pumping cash into these smaller leagues. And the Danish example that I give was a teen tournament where they're literally being playing in a park in Copenhagen, and they catch these four Chinese gambling monitors, like, you know, reporting the scores back to the illegal gambling market in Asia. It's like a bunch of 14-year-old kids. So I think that's it. But thank you very much for coming forward and sharing that story. I really appreciate that.
Thank you.
Thank you.
So we have a question from Michelle in Cambridge, Ontario. Declan, can you comment on corporate sponsorship in sports? Can or does sponsorship money stem the tide of bribery and match fixing?
Yeah, I do. I think corporate sponsorship can be used for good because no corporation, no matter who it is, wants to be tied with a toxic sport. So the example that I was giving today about the Chinese Soccer League, I mean, that's been a nightmare for their sponsors. Puma, which I think is one of the good guys in this world, pulled out of the South African Soccer Association exactly because of corruption and bribery and match fixing. He just said, hey, we're not going to have our name associated with this. And that was one of the impetuses. This is one of the factors which is gradually, hopefully, leading to a cleanup in South African soccer. Michelle, to carry on with your question, I believe that FIFA is a fundamentally flawed organization at this moment. And the only way we can clean up FIFA is by focusing on the sponsors. So I would urge people to write to FIFA sponsors and say, look, we like you, we like your product, but you're sponsoring this organization which is deeply flawed. We're going to buy your competitors until you clean this up.
Let's go over here. Hello, my name is Matt. I'm a history student at the University of Waterloo, and I've been a sports fan my whole life, but I never really paid attention much to soccer until I had a local team to support in Toronto FC. But so my question is, as someone who went to a lot of Toronto FC Academy games in the CSL, but now this is the first year that they were no longer sanctioned by the OSA or the CSA, and now that's been replaced by League One. So I basically washed my hands of the CSL because it's not
good
sanctioned anymore.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So I'm curious, do these match fixers, are they still betting on the CSL?
Oh yeah, absolutely. I mean, the CSL is now under a different rubric, as you know, but there's a series of sports gambling monitoring companies. I think there's four or five big ones around the world, and they routinely flag Canadian soccer, routinely, still. And I did a story last year, I think September of 2013, where the sports gambling company had come to me and said, look, we've approached Canadian soccer officials with this stuff. And these are usually red flags that would tip off other countries, and the Canadians hadn't done anything.
My other second question is also, as a big fan of major junior hockey, and just with the working conditions and stuff like that, I go to a lot of the University of Waterloo hockey games, and most of them, because I think the rules basically something like if you have like 18 months to try to play professional, and if you don't make it, like you don't get your scholarship if you try to make it into the NHL or something like that. So there's a lot of players on the University of Waterloo Warriors team, about two-thirds of them have played major junior hockey. So my question is, have you been approached by David Branch, or have you approached him with, you know, the working conditions? Because, I mean, like the last year, there were some rumblings about starting a union.
I have to be careful here. No, it's not for legal reasons, it's not for fear reasons, but Matt, I've spoken a lot and I've said a lot of outspoken things, so I don't want to speak about issues where I don't absolutely know the facts and lose credibility with you guys or with our online audience. But I can say for certain that nobody in Canadian hockey, and with only one exception in Canadian soccer, has come to me and said, what do we do? How do we protect our team or our sport from this? And this is in direct contact with Australians. I get phone calls from those guys and emails from them like virtually one a week. I've been flown out to Australia a number of times to consult with them and talk with them. I live a couple of blocks away from the Canadian Soccer Association. Never received anything from them. And if there was a whole nother protection stuff that was going on, okay, big deal, I'm just one guy. But there's nothing that's being put in place to protect Canadian sports. And to protect Canadian junior hockey, I will say this, is it just takes one phone line. Just one phone line for an anti-corruption, or if a player feels that he's been exploited. You know, Where does he report it to now?
So we need whistleblower protection.
You need whistleblower protection. It's basic. Thank you, Matt.
So let's go to the question here because it relates directly to the last one. This is from Laura in Toronto. Is there a fine line between the reliability of evidence that you're proffering and career damaging libel, which, I mean, it's libel and slander, so let's say defamation. And this is a clearly an issue you're struggling with all the time. You can see on the stage here you are. I know that you're extremely rigorous in the process of gathering evidence, and when you say something, there's a strong basis for it. But what's going on in your mind as you tell a story like this, both in your books and on the stage?
Look, number one, Laura, you have to be accurate, and you have to be truthful. I began the conversation here tonight saying, I wish I could talk about some of my methods, some of the academic methods that I used to analyze and bring this about and bring my work about. We didn't have time to do that, but much of what we have, and again, you couldn't see it because of our technological problems, is contained in tens of thousands of pages of documentation. And what I've done is something that academics do, but it's rare for investigative journalists to do, is things like geographical profiling, network analysis, bringing in new software to be able to see where the indications are in a network's line.
So you mentioned, again, in our conversation earlier, something very interesting about your statistical analysis of NFL players, where you were looking at, you know, when things start to go downhill for them. You're talking about the age. Is that something you'd be prepared to talk about?
Yes, but it wasn't about National Football League. There are two different stories. One is, when do players start fixing? You remember when Susan and I were joking around and we were talking about that, and I said that most players start to fix after they've reached the middle point in their career. Once they're starting to become elderly players, that's where fixing and corruption becomes a problem with the sport. But what I was saying about the National Football League was in response to a question, I think, from Brian, who was talking about North American sports. Brian is the chief of police here in Kitchener-Waterloo, and he was, you know, obviously interested. And I said, look, I have absolutely no evidence about National Football League. They pay their players very well. But what they don't do in National Football League is teach their players well to handle themselves after their career is over. And at this point, there's a shocking statistic where I think something like 50% of National Football League players are being declared bankrupt within 5 years of leaving their career. And that's a gateway to problems. And so there's clearly counseling, there's clearly education needed there.
So these folks don't really have any understanding of what they should do or what they can do when this most lucrative period in their entire lives ends suddenly in many cases.
Look, for athletes, it's really difficult because their entire life is being spent lionized, worshipped, idolized, people, you know, things. They'll get to a point, they'll get an injury, they'll get something, they just can't do it anymore, and bam, the attention just goes. And that is a really major problem and psychological problem. And one of my interests in research is mental health in sport, because mental health in sport, athletes' mental health is always regarded as how do I make this athlete win, as opposed to how do I make a healthy individual, a mentally healthy individual.
Let's go over here.
Okay, thank you very much. My name is Basil. I came from Toronto to listen to you.
Thank you, Basil. Thank you for driving on a cold night. I'm honored.
Yes,
thank
you. I am very happy that I did come. I just confirmed the suspicion that I have had about how sports is organized in North America and the rest of the developed world. Sports are, in these areas, is run along private lines. There is just limited government involvement in the running of sports. But when you come to Africa, it's much different. I'm not sure that the Canadian government gives money at all to the running of any of the sports that are available here. But looking at how soccer is organized in Africa, for example, government commits a lot of money into sports. which was why the example that you gave about Ghana and how they ferried some money to the World Cup in Brazil the last time was very, very appropriate at that time. So my sense is that you seem to be suggesting that in North America there needs to be some more government involvement in the running of sports to deal with gambling and fix it. While in Africa there seems to be the thinking that government is too involved and when this should be a matter for individuals to organize. So where is the line to be drawn? Because it raises serious governance issues. We don't know whether what we are dealing with is a private issue or is a public issue or a hybrid of those issues. So where should the line be drawn in terms of government involvement in sports?
First, let me say, Basil, as you know from having read my first book, it ends in a, quote, slum of Nairobi, Kenya. And I use the word slum because that's what the inhabitants of this particular area call it. It ends with a team of 13-year-old girls who've lived through mafia wars, invasions by the police, dozens of people killed, cholera epidemics. And the thing that has given those young girls power is football. I remember one of them saying to me, "You don't get it, do you?" Just looking at me saying, "You don't get it, do you?" He said, "Everything in our life is corrupt. When we write the school exams, it's corrupt. When we go to the hospital, we have to pay extra money for medicine. When we have to do, you know, we got caught in traffic, we face corruption. The only thing that is not corrupt in our life is when we walk onto that field and we play soccer." Sorry, I get a little moved when I tell that story, because this 13-year-old kid was explaining it to me. And she, as part of an organization called Matari Youth Sports Association, which empowers the people, it brings in a new way of governing sport. And I think that's a model. I think the solution, the future of at least football, soccer, is in Africa. The best players are coming from there. The talent is there. But I think it's very, very difficult to overstate the corruption in that continent. I did want to correct you on one point. I've never suggested that the solution to sports problem in Canada is more government interference or intervention. What I've suggested is that the sports authorities should get off their asses and start dealing with this problem. But I haven't suggested that politicians should be coming in and telling the NHL or anybody what to do.
I'm seeing a signal here that we need to wrap up, so thank you, Declan. And
thank
I'm
you.
Sorry for the people who are remaining to ask questions, but maybe they can talk to Declan
Certainly,
afterwards.
I'd be happy to talk to people afterwards.
And yeah. Fred Kunz is going to come up and give us the formal thank you.
Yes, I just want to make a few comments. First of all, thank you, Tad, for bringing Declan here and for helping to moderate the discussion so ably, but especially thank you, Declan Hill, for your remarkable presentation this evening and your work. You've helped to open our eyes to the size of the problem and how it works. Sports, as you suggested, should be something pure, a place where children can learn values, where lifelong friendships are built, and where the fans can enjoy the game without cynicism. Fix is a word with multiple meanings, and if the big fix is the problem of sports corruption, then you, by shedding light on the issue and encouraging discussion, and by opening people's eyes to the issue, are helping with maybe what might be the bigger fix, which is a solution. So thank you for your life work, and thank you for your inspiring remarks tonight.
Thank you, Fred.
The edited video of this evening's live webcast will be posted to the CG website. We'll also post a blog about this event where you can add your own comments. And in the near future, we invite you to join us for a couple of other public events at the CG Auditorium on Tuesday, January 27th. This Tuesday, we welcome you to join us for another signature lecture with conflict expert Pamela All, a CG senior fellow and one of the editors of the recently released book, Managing Conflict in a World Adrift. And then on February 3rd, we're excited to have Canadian archaeologists Marc-André Bernier and Douglas Stanton here to share their experiences of the hunt for the lost Franklin expedition and their discovery of the sunken Erebus. That lecture, I regret to say, is sold out here in the auditorium, but we invite you to sign up for the live webcast and to watch it online. So be sure to register for all of our events, our newsletter, and thank you for joining us this evening. Have a safe journey home.